Let's see your Bibles. Remember, we're Faith Church. Let's see your Bibles. Let's see your Bibles. Let's start our Bibles in the book of Numbers. Book of Numbers. Is that a book? Is that a book in the Bible? Yes, it is. It's in the Old Testament. It's part of the first five books called the Pentateuch or the Torah. So, Book of Numbers, chapter 35. And I'm very excited today. I'm rejuvenated. I thank my co-pastors for filling up the last two Sundays and preaching amazing messages about just the power of the Holy Spirit. Today, we're going to go topical today, and we're going to start a new series after Mother's Day called One Another. Say one another. I'll give you more information about that next week. But let's all bow our heads and let's pray together. Father God, Lord, we thank you so much that you are God, that is our refuge. Amen. And every time we say this, Lord God, what does it really mean, Lord, that we say that you are our refuge, you are our strength. You are the place of safety when we feel scared, when we feel fearful, Lord God. What does it mean, Lord God, to stay in your presence, to seek for you? As we search you, you said that we will find you. And what does it mean that we are under your care? And that we are safe in your arms? Could anything ever harm come our way? Father, may this question, Lord God, be answered this morning. If we ever have doubt, if we have fear, may you comfort our weakness with your word. And may we offer you this time, Lord God, as we pray and we ask this, God, in Jesus' mighty name. Everybody says, amen. Amen. I was watching the news the other day, and they have a guest on, I think it was a Fox 5 News, and they have a guest, a child psychiatrist, and they were talking about spanking children. Filipinos, you know, pretty much grew up, some people are not, you know, supportive of spanking kids. Some people are okay with that. You know, when I went here, when I was in the Philippines, of course, there's no such thing whether you like it or not. You know, you're gonna see some chinelas flying in the air. You know, I've tasted chinelas, I've tasted belt, I've tasted just old-fashioned hand spanking. Made me a good boy, made me a good boy. And they were just arguing whether it's you condone it or not. And so I was watching it and just reminded me back in the Philippines, every time I would get spanked, you know, you have to understand, I'm not saying I'm condoning it, I'm not saying I'm against it as well. I just feel like as parents, there are parts sometimes that your kids could be really knuckleheads, that a little bit of this, a little bit of that would it hurt. But it just reminded me when I was in the Philippines. In the Philippines, there's no choice. You gotta understand that. You gotta get. How many of you got some spanking in the Philippines? Made you a really good boy, right? We're gonna pray for you later. I know you're scarred for life. I'm scarred for life. But in the Philippines, it's not a choice. You're either gonna get spanked, you're gonna get, or in Tagalog, palo. You know, I tell my kids now, you want palo? And they just smile at me and they don't take me seriously. But it reminds me, every time I get found in the Philippines, you cannot stop it. Let's say that together. Say, you cannot stop it. But I know how to minimize it. Okay? You cannot tell your parents, no, don't follow me. I'm going to do everything. No, there's no such thing. Especially with my mom. Oh my gosh. Good thing she's born again now. I wish she was born again then. But now, I tell her, paddle my kids. And she's like, no, I don't want to do it. Anyways, I know how to minimize it. You know how I do that? Grandparents. Grandparents. Parents, don't trust the grandparents to raise your children. Because all they're going to do is spoil them. That's what they're good at. I feel like grandparents, they feel some guilt raising the children, so they want a second chance for grandparents, so they spoil them. So parents, That's okay. Give the children to grandparents just to spoil them. But for discipline, that's you. Okay? I knew how to minimize spanking. Because I already know that I'm going to get spanked. If I do something, I already know. They're going to come home, 6 o'clock, they're going to change clothes, we're going to have dinner first, and then we're going to get the spanking. And lucky for me, because I live with my grandparents. And so what I would do, or sometimes spanking comes just out of nowhere. Right? They call that phantom spanking. Like, bang! Is that surprise where that come from? Did I tell you to go already? Go! You know, some people get spanked, they don't even know they got spanked, they just start crying. You know, I've been all that. But I remember I would go always to my Lola, my Nana Rosa. Because my Nana Rosa, every time I know that he's fucking, I would call my Nana and I'd say, Nana, come with me. And we will go home together and I could see my mom. And my mom's like, I would still get it, but it will be minimized. Why? Because my Lord will be, okay, that's enough. No, that's enough. I had the best childhood. I always say that, and you probably see that to me. I always share my childhood because I experienced so much that I see now how it applies to our Christian life. My Lola, during that time, I saw her as my refuge. I saw her that when I'm with her, I'm safe. And not only in a sense, if I'm going to get disciplined. My Lola helped raise me while my parents would go to work. So I always stay with my grandparents. And the kind of love that I experienced growing up with my grandparents, also with Nana Kika, the kind of love made me feel like I will be safe. How many of you could just say amen to that kind of love that you experienced? Maybe when you're growing up. Some of you are probably a bad child, and that's a different case. But I experienced that kind of love. There's just love that when you feel like that presence of that person, mostly that our parents, mostly grandparents, whatever it is, that you say that as long as this person is here with me, I'm safe. That is my refuge. You know, the Bible says that God is our refuge and our strength. You know, we all have heard it so many times. We even say it, we even proclaim it, that God is my refuge and my strength. But the question for us this morning, and this is, I believe, what God just wants to remind us, is to really understand what it means when we say that God is our refuge. Human beings, we feel fearful at times. There are times that we do not go to sleep because there are so many things that we are looking forward to that is unknown. And we're asking God, I just want to feel your presence. I just want you to comfort me right now and remind me and assure me that I will be safe. When we say that God is our refuge, what we're saying is God, there's no place that could make me feel safe other than you. The safety that you provide for me is irreplaceable. Of course, you have blessed me in my life, things, people, places that kept me safe. But God, you are my refuge. And there's no place I will ever feel safe other than in your presence and in your love. Let's turn our Bibles in the book of Numbers. And in the story that we're going to look at today, here, the second generation. The first generation of Israelites doubted God. They sent the 12 spies, and the 40-day journey turned into what? 40 years. Why? Because they doubted God. And God says, all that generation will die, and the new generation will enter the promised land. And here God is telling this second generation, now you are about to enter the promised land. Say, promised land? And God is saying, I'm going to divide this land because there are how many tribes in Israel? Okay, I'm going to ask that again. How many tribes of Israel? 12. How many tribes? There are 12 tribes. So I know you probably, when you enter the land, you're probably thinking, okay, you know, first person gets here, claim the land. No. God says, I'm going to do it orderly. That's why the book of Numbers is called Numbers. Because there's so many mentions of numbering there. The numbering of the Israelites, the numbering of people, the numbering of the land, the measurement, what land goes to who and what not. And so God is telling these people, telling them, okay, you're going to come into the land, but I'm going to divide it among you. And here in this story, we're going to see something that is very interesting that really caught my eye. And I believe that many times when we say that God is our refuge, let's say that together. God is my refuge. Let's say that again. Turn to the person next to you. Say, God is my refuge. Every time we say that, we just think that God is like a place that we just go to and we feel like, God, I find safety in you. And some of us even think that, oh, God is my refuge, he's my strength. Or other people say, strength with a K. That means, God, you are my strength. But how much do we really believe that? How much do we really believe that God can bring us safety? Because there are people that trust in God and still get sick, don't get healed, sometimes get into just bad accidents. Does that mean that God failed to be a refuge for them? And as we look at it in this context, my prayer and my hope is that we will have a clear understanding of what refuge means. Because sometimes it's one of the things that become a cliche for us as believers. Can I hear that? Amen. Oh yeah, God is my refuge. What do you mean by that? Here I'll give you a context of what a place of refuge is really like. Numbers 35. Let's read verse 1. It says here, On the plains of Moab, the Jordan across from Jericho, the Lord said to Moses, command the Israelites to give the Levites towns to live in. You have to understand that only the Levites were separated from all the tribes. Why? Because God says only the Levites will be a tribe of priesthood. Only this tribe will be set apart so that their very purpose is to work in the what? In the temple. In the sanctuary of God. And all the Levites are going to dedicate their lives just doing that. And so he commanded them, it says here, so the Israelites to give the Levites towns to live in from the inheritance the Israelites will possess, and give them pasture lands. Say pasture lands? Around the towns. Then they will have towns to live in and pasture lands for their cattle, flocks, and their other livestock. Why? Because that's going to be the source of what? Sacrifice during that time. The pasture lands around the town that you give the Levites will extend out 1,500 feet. How many feet? God's very specific. 1,500 feet from the town wall, outside the town, measured 3,000 feet. How many feet? 3,000. On the east side, 3,000. On the other side, 3,000 on the west and 3,000 on the north. With the town in the center, they will have this area. Pasture land for the towns. So what they're saying, God is establishing the Israelites to be self what? Sufficient. You're gonna separate lands, and you know, for people who are in land development or realty, this is a very good book to read. Because you can see the orchestration of God when we say that you're not just gonna enter the land and just do whatever you want. No, there's a strategy to this. It's gonna be your land, it's gonna be your land, but you're going to give lands or pasture lands to the Levites so you can, that will sustain your what? Your living. You're going to eat off of what you plant. You're going to eat off what of you kill or what you get out from those pasture lands, and it will be sufficient for this whole nation. So God is orchestrating this. But look at verse 6, and this is where the context of what it means that God is our refuge, I want us to understand. And many of you probably never heard of this before. Of where the place or the name refuge originated from. Look at verse 6. Let's read verse 6. Verse 6 says, Six of the towns you give the Levites will be. How many towns? And those towns are going to be cities of what?
Refuge.
Let's say it together. Say, ooh.
Ooh.
One more time. Say it together. Say,
ooh.
Say, ah. Because I'm about to tell you what that means. Very interestingly, God is saying, I want you all tribes to give pasture lands to the Levites. But here's a new concept that I want you guys to get. Six of those towns you give to the Levites will be cities of
refuge.
A place of safety. For what? God, aren't you giving this land? Because this land in itself is already a place of refuge. Didn't you take us out of the land of Egypt because we were oppressed there? So you told us you're going to give us a promised land so that in promised land it will be flowing with what? Milk and honey. So what are you saying now that there's going to be six cities that will be named cities of refuge? Well, look what it says here. It says here, what is it for? Give the Levites will be cities of refuge to which a person who has killed someone may flee. A person who may kill someone may flee. In addition, give them 42 other towns. What is God saying? You are to give the Levites 48 towns. 48. 6 minus 48 is 42. So there's 42 left. And the 6 are cities of refuge. Booyah, that's some math for you. God saying 48 towns to be given to the Levites as pasture lands. But, 6 of them will be what? Cities of refuge. What is the purpose of the cities of refuge? It's not that any refugee camp, so when the storm comes, you go there. It's not any other places where you just go there if you feel scared. There's a purpose to it. The purpose to it is specifically God says that those who may have killed someone can go there and flee. And later on we're going to see that those who may have killed someone, when they go to a city of refuge, they are what? Safe. What does that mean? Later on, as we read the context, we understand that God is saying those who may have killed someone unintentionally. There are different kinds of murders. Are you with me? First degree, second degree, third degree, manslaughter, homicide, suicide. Are you with me? And the law of Moses says that the capital punishment for murder is simply what? Death. And so God, with his wisdom and sovereignty, he's already thinking that, okay, I know I give the law, and I said those who have killed someone who is guilty of murder will be killed. But God understands that, okay, there are situationals. There are people who might kill someone because they just defended themselves. But the law says that they still have to die. So what God did is God says, no, because of my sovereign power, because I understand this whole thing, here's what I'm going to do. There's going to be 6 cities. If you have killed someone unintentionally, you can go to one of these cities and you will be what? Safe. River Faith Church, the Bible says that God has designated this places because God was looking forward and saying that there are designated places in your life that I put it as a place of refuge. How many of us here are not guilty of anything? We are guilty of sin. And I want you to understand this picture. You have to understand that God is the master showman. Every little single thing that you read in the Old Testament, guess what? Get clarified and becomes clear in the New Testament. Are you with me? Amen. When God told Moses, speak to the rock, what did Moses do? He got mad and what? Struck the rock. And later on in the book of Corinthians, what did Paul say? The rock is who? Jesus Christ. In the book of John, it says when the serpent was raised, those who were bitten would look up to the serpent that's made out of bronze were what? Were healed. It's the same picture that when what? Jesus Christ was raised up, people will be healed. Not just physically, but spiritually. When God told Abraham to sacrifice his only son, what does the book of John 3:16 tell us? For God so loved what? What? Turn the person that you say, what? God did that? You're just not paying attention. You're not reading your Bible. Every time you see this is what you call types of Christ. In theology, there's a lot of types of Christ, meaning it's a picture then that God is painting, which they didn't know that it was about Jesus Christ. And later on in the New Testament, they were like, what? Is that what it was? And you're going to see here now, you're going to have a clearer understanding every time you mention that God is my refuge. All the Old Testament writers, especially in the book of Psalms, when David said that God is my refuge and my strength, you know what he was thinking? I am guilty of sin. There's no place that could make me safe other than what? The place of refuge. That's what God provides. He is a place of safety for those who are what? Guilty. So when you're saying that God is my refuge, what? First thing that you're saying is, yes, I am guilty and I am fleeing because I deserve punishment. And you know what? You came to the right place because Jesus Christ is now our righteousness. Can I hear an amen? Let's keep our mind to God and pray to our God this morning. Are you with me, Mr. Baker? I like how your eyes just lit up. It's like some new information that came to you, right? Number one in our notes this morning, look what it said. Take out your notes, write something there, make me feel better, because I work hard on that. And put it in your Bible, and don't read it, just like what Pastor Jay asked last time, if you ever go back to it. I admire that because you trust me, but just don't trust me. Read your Bible. Number one in our notes, write it down. The cities of refuge were God's designated, say designated? Designated place of providence. Safety. As God prepared the Israelites to enter the land, he promised them that he will make sure the land will be divided to all tribes of Israel. So he gave Moses an instruction that it will be their responsibility to give those other lands to the Levites. And guess what? Six of them, say six.
Six.
Say six.
Six.
Will be cities of refuge. Here's a challenge for us today. I believe that God has always designated a place of refuge in our lives. Here's the problem. Sometimes we run away from them. Oh yeah, Pastor, I ran away when I was 12. Forget that. I'm not going to live under, you know, my parents or this. Oh yeah, I don't need to go to school, you know. Oh yeah, I don't need to do this. I don't need to stay in church. Here's what I want us to get this morning. As God convicts you, what were the places of refuge in your life? Think about it. Maybe it was home. You know, I grew up in a rough neighborhood. I was a gangster. I just like to say that because there's little people nowadays. Oh, I grew up in Bronx, man. You know, it's a rough neighborhood. I grew up in Tondo. You tell Filipinos about Tondo, they're like, I don't want to fight. I I hate fighting. I'm a scaredy cat. I grew up in Toronto, and half of my life I lived there. I came here when I was 16, and I am now 31, 32, somewhere around there. Half of my life I grew up there, half of my life I grew up here. 16 years ago I was crying, bawling my eyes out because I don't want to leave that place. I didn't know what God was going to do. But if you ask me now, 16 years, if I know that this is where God's going to lead me to, I would probably say, God, you know what you're doing. You're with me.
Amen.
There are places in your life that God put you there, but you don't want to be there. There are cities of refuge in your life that God says, no, I put you there, but God, I don't want to be here. But God is saying, no, as long as you're in that place, you'll be safe, you'll be under my care. But if you want to aloof, and if you want to just go around and you just want to run around and get away from that, then you can do it. But you can see the context here that God is saying, I designated those places in your life because that I put that in your life to keep you safe. There's no doubt in my mind that God allowed me to grow up with my parents and with my grandparents. Why? Because even in a rough neighborhood, I knew the difference. I knew the difference. I knew exactly the difference between what is the good thing to do and what is not. It's not the place you're in. It's who is with you in that place. Are you with me? Are we getting this, River Faith Church? Don't just ask God for, I just want a house. No, God, bring me a place of refuge. Give me a designated place of providence. Sometimes God has already given you a place of providence in your job, has given you security. Something goes wrong, you don't want it. And guess what? No, God, I'm going to change. Why? And God said, no, no, I want you to stay here. This is your place of refuge. You know what I cannot tell you? When I was working a secular job, there was a time, I've been working there for over 5 years, and they sent me off-site, Rosecrans. So I was thinking I have to drive extra 16 miles than what I'm used to, and they're not paying for my mileage. And so I was like, I think I can come. What is this? You know, 16 miles and the gas prices during the time was high. I don't have no more money to date. You know, so I have to impress my girlfriend back there, which is my wife now. Every time we eat out, no, I'm paying for it, I can't. And now you have to drive 16 miles and you have to pay for gas. And let me tell you, I said, God, I don't want that. I don't want to be here. I want to stay where I'm at. Little did I know that God says, no, that's going to be a place of refuge. Why? And you know, some of my friends are here. They can testify to this. During the times that I was there, the company slowed down, started firing people one by one. One by one. One by one. One by one. Guess what? I was off-site. There's always a job. Guess what? Guess what? I never had to worry about this much. Can I hear an amen?
Amen?
Can we give a hand to our God this morning? Little did you know that it's your Goshen. The place in Egypt where Joseph ended up. Years after he was sold as a slave. Years after his brothers tried to kill him. Can you imagine that if you're Joseph, you'll be like, God, are you really my refuge? Because my brothers here just sold me as a slave. And I ended up with being a slave, a Potiphar's, you know, servant and all this. And at the end of the story, where did he end up? In Egypt, in Goshen, where all the land has what? Has famine, no food. Guess where there is food? Goshen. God has given you designated place of refuge. You don't need to say, oh, God is my refuge. You say, God, is this my place of refuge. Are you with me? Here's my challenge to you this morning. If you are thinking of moving, if you are thinking of changing, if you are thinking of replacing, if you are thinking of relocating, if you are thinking of all of that, here's my question to you. Is the place you're going to a God-specific place of refuge? Or you just feel like it? Oh, I'm going to leave this job because I don't get along with my supervisor. And God's saying, I've been faithful with you in this job for the last 20 years, and you're just going to leave because you don't like something else. And here's all of us Christians. Well, I prayed for it. Yeah, what did God say? Because praying for it doesn't just verify that you can move. Are you with me? Because you can be in a place in your life right now where things could be falling apart, but when God says, no, that is a place of refuge, guess what? No matter what happens, you will be safe.
Amen.
There are many times in our life that we want to give up. Oh, I don't want to be in this place, God. It's so uncomfortable. The things have changed, etc., etc. Here's one thing you need to ask God. God, do you want me to be here? Is this one of the places that you said, a designated place of refuge? Because if I'm here, I could be guilty. Things could be falling apart. But guess what? You said it's a place of refuge. So it is a place of refuge.
Amen.
A challenge for us. If you're living, this for what? If it's emotional based, there will be consequences. If it's spiritual based, there's going to be fruits. Are you with me? You know, some of you in your career, in your job, whatever. Well, pray about it, man. Pray more. Pray more. Why are you going to that place? Young people, why are you going to that college? Well, because I've had 5-star rating. That's good. Here's my challenge to you. Pray, God, I'm going this place. Make this a place of refuge for me. Because there are many times in our life that we decided, oh God, I don't want to be in this place where you gave me, I'll go over there, and guess what happens? Things start falling apart. Well, God told me, no, he didn't tell you. God says, leave me out of it, that's all you. You already know, I already told you stay with your parents. I already told you stay in school. I already told you stay in church. I already told you all these places that I'm telling you to stay are my designated place of refuge. But something that makes you unhappy changes everything. Are you with me? Don't be that person. Understand when you say that God is my refuge, you understand that it is not the place that you're going to. It is the God who is with you that matters. It is the God that is with you that matters. It's very important for us when we make decisions that we ask God, God, are you going to be with me if I go here? Instead of just assuming, oh yeah, God is always with me. Yes, he is. But there are places that you go to, that God is saying, no, I ain't going with you there. Well, Pastor, they went to the strip club over there. How do you know? You were there too. Well, they were there happy hour, Pastor. They were drinking this. I know exactly what they were drinking. How do you know? You were there too. It's not the place, people. Are you with me? Number two, number two. Look what it says here. Let's continue reading. Verse 7. In all you must give the Levites 48 towns together with the pasture lands. The towns you give the Levites from the land the Israelites possess are to be given in proportion to the inheritance of each tribe. Take many towns from a tribe that has many, but few from the one that has few. And look what it says here. Then the Lord said to Moses, speak to the Israelites and say to them, when you cross the Jordan into Canaan, select some towns to be your cities of? Select some towns to be your cities of refuge to which a person who has killed someone accidentally may. They will be places of refuge from the what? From the danger. The law Moses says, an eye for an eye. A tooth for a what? A tooth. If you kill my friend, I have the right to avenge his blood. That's why God is saying, no, we're not going to do it like that. There's going to be cities of refuge when you actually can go there. And if you go there, you can wait because they're going to touch you. And you can wait for a fair trial. God is saying, look what it says here in verse, continuing in verse 12, there will be places of refuge from the avenger so that a person accused of murder may not die before he stands trial, before the assembly. The six towns you give will be your cities of
refuge.
Give three on this side of the Jordan, three in the Canaan, cities of refuge. These six towns will be a place of refuge for Israelites, aliens, and any other living among them, so that anyone who has killed another accidentally may what? May flee. You know, we have a place like that today. You know what it's called? Tijuana. If you committed a crime here, guess where you go? Well, you can only go there if you get past Pastor Bird. Good thing Pastor Bird's retired. You're not gonna get past Pastor Bird. Pastor Bird used to come with the old belt here. Pastor Bird, what are you doing? We're in church. Oh, I just came from work. Grenades, launcher. Like, Pastor, you're wearing the full armor of God, huh? You're going to war, spiritual war. Number two, now I know. The guilty were safe in the city of refuge. Are you guys starting to see the picture now? How is this going to relate to Jesus Christ? Are we starting to see the picture now? Those who are killed unintentionally will have no protection. When Cain killed Abel, Abel killed him. Did I say it right? I got it right this time. When Cain killed Abel, he told God, God, put a mark on my forehead so that my brother's avenger will not go against me. Why? Because after the dispensation of incense, it's the dispensation of conscience. And the Bible says that those who kill someone has the right to avenge it. And so Cain says, God, put a mark on my forehead so they won't kill me. They will know that you vindicate me. When you kill someone, whether it is unintentional or intentional, you are guilty. Are you with me? Of course, there are different kinds of murder. There's intentional, there is, you know, premeditated murder. There's a self-defense murder. There's just, a manslaughter or, you know, accidental that someone died. But what is God saying? God is saying, look here. Turn to the person next to you and say, look here. I'm painting you a picture of what the Messiah would do. All the guilty people who is deserving of death, who is deserving of punishment, guess what? You have a place you can go to. You have a place that you can go to where you can be what? You can be treated fairly until there is a trial. Until that it is ready to, so you can make your case. Because if not, then guess what? The avengers will what? Will kill you. And I love what it says here. They have to what? Flee. Flee. You're talking, all of a sudden you're arguing and this person strike you. And you do the matrix, and you strike back, and you end up killing this person, and nobody sees it. Guess what? You're doomed according to the law of Moses. Because those person's family, friends, what? They're going to go out after your blood. So this person is now what? Now you're wondering, where am I going to go? Where am I going to go? How can I get safety? God says, I have a safety place for you. Are you in the River Faith Church? Doesn't that sound familiar when we sin against God? Well, nobody knows. Yeah, nobody knows, but you know. What Cain did you tried to cover it up. Am I my brother's keeper now? God says, the blood of your brother shouting to me and waiting to be avenged. And so all these people that's coming now that killed someone intentionally, guess what? Now they truly understand what it means to have a place of refuge. Are you with me? You probably didn't know that before, didn't you? Well, Pastor, everybody else is saying God is my refuge, so it sounds nice. It sounds nice when I say God is my refuge. I'm a refugee. If you put that in the context, those people are refugees. They were what? Fleeing. Yes. What is the point? The place of refuge, you don't earn it. You don't build it yourself. You don't even think about it. What? The place of refuge is God's all wisdom. Thinking ahead of us and saying, you're going to mess up. Here's what I'm going to do. You know when my son was 2 years old, 1 year old, started walking, guess what we do? We bulletproof pretty much the staircase. We put a gate. We put locks on the what? On anything that he would touch that could what? Hurt him. Why? Because that is that's you show you love that person. Are you with me? Amen. You're preventing things that you know could happen. What God is saying, I love you this much. You are guilty, but still, guess what? There are 6 cities that you can go over there. And I love how God did it. God says, 3 over here, 3 over here. And guess what? Wherever you are, you have to flee and go get it. Because most of us here, we sit and we're like, no, I'm cool. If God wants to save me, God will save me. And God says, no, if you want to flee, I'm here. It's a city of refuge. Come over here. Look what it says here. Let's continue reading because this one is really will make it really solid and you will thank me for it. And you'll just love Pastor Ray for it. Ah, thank you, Pastor. You're the best pastor ever. Verse 16. If a man strikes someone with an iron, how many of you ever struck someone with an iron? With an iron object so that he dies. He is a murderer. And there's one thing I'm just going to throw in there. Jesus Christ says, under grace, not under the law anymore. If some of you call your brother Raha, or you fool, you know what the Bible says? You have committed murder in your heart. If someone of you hates your brother or your sister, you have committed what? Murder. How many of you are murderers here? We all have. In heart. Not by action. By heart. Because the book, because under grace with Jesus Christ. Some say, oh well, the law is so harsh. Pastor, what do they have to do all these things? You know, the law is giving us so high standard. Actually, the grace is higher. Because the law says if you sleep with a married woman, if you sleep with someone, you have committed what? Adultery. But grace says, if you just look at someone lustfully, you already committed it. That's under grace. But guess what? Because we are under grace, we're not under the law. It's not about our action. It's about our faith in Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. That we are under grace. Can I hear an amen? Let's give a hand to our God. Or if anyone has a stone in his hand that could kill and he strikes someone so that he dies, he is a? The murderer shall be? Or if anyone has a wooden object in his hand that could kill and he hits someone so that he dies, he is a? The murderer shall be put to death. The avenger of blood shall put the murderer to death. When he meets him, he shall put him to death. If anyone with a malice, a forethought, shoots another or throws something at him intentionally so that he dies, in hostility he hits him with his fist, so that he dies, the person shall be put to death. He's a murderer, the avenger of blood shall put the murderer to death when he meets him. So God is just saying, if you do this thing and you end up killing someone, you're what? You are guilty. And I want you guys to understand the meaning of this from the Old Testament concept and from the New Testament concept. Paul says that this is why we're not under the law anymore, because if you break one, you what? You break them all. But grace says there is no such condemnation now for those who are in Christ Jesus. There is no Greeks, there is no Jews, there's no Gentiles, if we surrender our life to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, because the blood of Christ covered all of this. Are you with me? The Bible says, continue reading. But without hostility, verse 22, someone suddenly shows another or throws something at him unintentionally. Say unintentionally. Unintentionally. How do you know if something is unintentionally? That's a trick question. I look at your face like, what? Only you knows if you really do that intentionally or unintentionally. Oh, I didn't mean it, Pastor. Yeah, right? Or without seeing him, drops a stone. Sometimes, you know, the Bible just gives you humor. Look what it says there. Or without seeing him, but drops a stone on him that could kill him. I'm sorry. Right? Someone was like that. Oh, I didn't know you were there. Yeah, you do. You dropped a stone that killed him. How could you not know that he was there? Look at verse 24. And he died since this was not his enemy. He did not intend to harm him. The assembly must judge between him and the avenger of blood according to this regulation. The assembly must protect the one accused of murder from the avenger of blood and send him back to the city of refuge to which he fled. He must stay there until, and this is why I just love this. Let's just take a moment just to absorb this. Because this will just, the Bible says that one of the types of Christ was Melchizedek. Say Melchizedek. I didn't make that up, because I always say, oh, I'm going to name my son. I didn't make that up. Like in the book of Genesis, when Abraham plundered and was able to save Lot, his nephew, he had a lot of plunder. And his natural response was to what? To tithe. He gave 10% to what they called during the time the high priest in the highest order, which during that time there was no Levites yet. Are you with me? No Levites, no priests, no concept of priests yet. But during that time, the Bible says that Abraham offered his tenth offering to the priest in the highest of order by the name of Melchizedek. And Melchizedek was a high priest. And in the book of Hebrews says that now Jesus Christ has surrendered his blood, he spilled his blood, and paid for the sins of the world that no animal could ever do. He is now our what? High priest. That's why Jesus is PPK. He is prophet. He is king. He is, I forgot the other P. Prophet, king, priest. There you go. Thank you. You were there in the class. He was PPK. He was prophet, priest, and king. He is now our high priest in heaven. You know what priest does? You know, Filipinos, when they hear that I'm pastor, they call me father. I love it. Father Ray. Okay. I love that when I was working. Oh, talk to Father Ray, because I don't know why I said that, but the priest's job, here's the priest's job, is a mediator between God and his people. That's their job description. 1 Timothy says that we have now one mediator between God and man. His name is who?
Jesus.
Jesus Christ. Now prepare your minds to be blown. As you can see, the correlation, look what it says here. The assembly must protect the one accused of murder from the avenger of blood and send him back to the city of refuge to which he fled. He must stay there until the death of a high priest who has what? And look what it says here in verse 26. But if the accused ever goes outside, if you know that you are guilty and you happen to go to the place of refuge and you go over there and you say, oh, I don't like the bed here. Oh, there's no AC. Oh, there's no, you know, they don't even have a swimming pool. And you say, oh, I don't like it here. And you go outside. Look what it says here. And goes outside the limits of the city of refuge to which he fled. The avenger of blood finds him outside the city. The avenger what? May kill him. Accused without being guilty of murder. Here's the thing. If the avenger finds you outside of the city of refuge, guess what? He can kill you and what? Free of charge. Free of charge. He can kill you according to the law. No problem. He will not go to jail or anything else. Why? Because you are outside the city of refuge. Are we getting this, River Faith Church? How important it is to understand that God is our refuge. You must stay there to stay in the what? City of refuge. It's just like Wi-Fi. You gotta go to a hotspot to get Wi-Fi. Guess what? When you walk out, there's no more Wi-Fi. Because there is erasure. And look what it says here. In verse 28, the accused must stay in this city of refuge. Here's what I want you guys to get. Until the death of the high priest, only, hallelujah, only after the death of a high priest, he may return to his own property. You are acquitted. Are you with me, everybody, church? You're probably just calculating in your mind right now, what does that mean, high priest? Jesus Christ is high priest. When Jesus Christ died, he paid for the sins of the world. The temple says there was a split from top to bottom, and it's open. There's no more now holy of holies. And in the Old Testament, God's saying, if the high priest during that time dies, guess what? You're what? You're acquitted. Are you with me? When Jesus Christ died, Satan says, oh snap, I have no power over them anymore. I have no power over them anymore. The Bible calls him the accuser of the brethren. When Jesus Christ died, Satan says, start looking the law. The law of Moses. No, wait. If they don't do this, I know there's a loophole here somewhere. I know if they fail to do this offering, I know that. And Satan's like, what? When Jesus Christ died, those who are covered by his blood are now what? When you are born again, your life is a liar, your life is an addict, your life is a molester, your life is a slander, your life is a murderer, your life is all these things. Break every chain. All chains are suddenly what? Broken. How wonderful that God in the Old Testament, without them even knowing, and how ironic that God would even mention, you will not be acquitted, but if a death of a high priest, some people are probably staying there for a long time already, and the death of a high priest, and they find out that the high priest has died, and they can see the gate of the city of refuge, and they can see the avenger there, like this. Like this, or like Pastor Bird with all the But when the diaper is dyed, imagine if you are the guilty person and you're avenger. You're avenger, the destroyer of soul, which the Bible describes in the book of Peter is like a roaring lion crouching at the door, waiting for someone to what? To devour. They were over there. But when the priest died, guess what? They were standing there. They cannot wait to kill you. And you just step your foot outside the gate and you walked out. And they're looking at you and they're like, I cannot do anything. He's acquitted. Hallelujah. Can you hear? Can I hear an amen? Amen. Are we getting this? Oh my God. Are we getting this? God is my refuge. He's not just a cliche. You have to understand what that really means. When the prophets of old says, God is my refuge and my strength. What they're saying is, I don't have no other place to go. I am hopeless. I am helpless. But in the city of refuge, even though I am guilty, I am safe. Why would anyone ever want to live Jesus Christ? I don't get it. Why would anyone would ever says, I'm done with the church business. I'm done with the Jesus thing business. I'm done with it. That is the only place that you can be guilty and still feel safe. River Faith Church, God has given you places of refuge right now in your life. Don't be too itchy to say, oh, I don't want to hear anymore. Here's one thing I want you to challenge you with. Ask this question, God, is this the place where I am right now? Your designated place of refuge in my life. Why? Things could be falling apart. 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 But guess what? Standing on solid rock. It's standing on solid rock. Can I hear an amen? Let's give your hand to our God. The last point as we close, I ask the worship team to come forward. The cities of refuge were a what? It was a type of Christ. Where sinners find safety from the destroyer. Turn the person next to you and tell that person, now you know.
Now you know.
Now you know when you say that God is my refuge. Now you know when you say that God is my strength. What you're really saying is, I am a guilty person, fleeing from my crimes. But the only place I could be safe is the place of refuge. And in today's context, if you say that Jesus is your refuge, you are safe. Amen. 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 Let's give a hand to our God. Let's all stand up and let's pray together, Heavenly Father.
Thank you, Lord.
What beautiful word you've given us, Lord, this morning. Is this a place are we in the area in our life right now, Lord, that we can say, God, that where we are, Lord God, is your designated place of refuge. Give us the right mind, the right conviction, Lord God, to know the difference of a place that could promise wealth, that could promise prosperity, but your providence is not there. Let us be reminded of this. This prodigal son who left his father's home, a designated place of refuge, and thought that he could be outside and still be well, only to realize that there's no replacement for a place of refuge that you designated in our lives. And I pray, Lord God, this morning, we may have some doubts, we may have some fears, we may have some worries in our lives right now, Lord. Decisions, Lord God, that we have to make. Maybe a change, Lord God, in our life, in our career, in our... in general, Lord God. As you remind us, Lord, what it means to have a place of refuge. I pray, Lord God, this morning, as you confirm in our lives where you called us to be. Confirm in our lives that there's no place better and there's no place we'd rather be than the place that you designated as a place of refuge. God, you are our refuge, you are our strength. And we say this not because we just heard it, we say this because we have experienced it. Father God, thank you for this day. As we sing to you, you are our refuge, you are our strength. We thank you, Father. So pray this in Jesus' name, and everybody says, amen. Amen. Come on, give my God praise, Father God.
Amen, amen. Come on, let's give it out of hand. Amen, amen. The name of Jesus is our refuge. Amen. The name of Jesus.
Sorry.
Broken away in this name. God bless you all.